Hi, everypony. Slap the knee, slap Tano here, the internet's busiest music nerd, and it's time for a review of the new A.G. Cook album, 7G. Alexander Guy Cook, super producer, singer, songwriter, head of the PC Music label. If you didn't know, the dude has become one of the most cutting-edge forces in pop music in the past 5 years or so, not simply because of the groundbreaking sounds and aesthetics coming out of the PC Music camp, but also the incredible amount of work he's put in with Charlie XCX in developing what you could call the shape of pop to come, playing executive producer on all of her newest and most daring works. Number One Angel, Pop 2, Charlie, How I'm Feeling Now. So over this last half a decade, I've become more and more familiar with the A.G. Cook name through production credits, through crossovers with like 100 Gex, Caroline Polachek, Tommy Cash. When I think about an A.G. Cook track, it's not usually in the context of an original, a solo original. I mean, maybe a remix and that's it. But the A.G. Cook catalog just got a lot deeper with the release of 7G. With 2 hours and 39 minutes of runtime, this project is immense. Cook has dropped the amount of music it takes average artists to put out over the course of like 5 or 6 years. But on 7G, he's released it in 7 different chunks or discs, all of which average out to 20 minutes or so, feature 7 tracks each, and all have a slightly different instrumental emphasis. There is one disc here that's more guitar driven, another that's more drum driven, one more where you might see pianos or some spoken word vocals taking the lead. But that doesn't mean each disc on this project is stylistically consistent or predictable, because from front to back, 7G is a total and utter crapshoot in terms of what you will hear and how good it actually is. As you transition from one track to the next on this record, you have no idea if you're about to hear something that's more ambient leaning, some bubblegum bass, some dance music, something that's more synth poppy or clubby, a progressive synth electronic piece, drum and bass or IDM, something that's more rock oriented, a hyper ballad pop anthem, or even like a deconstructed club piece. There are covers on this project too. Covers of The Strokes, Smashing Pumpkins, Taylor Swift, and Sia, just to name a few. This album is so all over the place and so sprawling, even knowing some of the instrumental parameters guiding each disc doesn't make this record any easier to digest or make heads or tails of, honestly. I will say that while I find some discs to be more enjoyable than others, they all have their duds, they all have their triumphs, they all have their weird moments that you kind of wish weren't there or you wonder why they are there. Cook is really not shy on this one about throwing in everything but the kitchen sink. To the point for me it becomes difficult to accurately and efficiently sum this project up for you, the viewer, because ultimately 7G feels like I've just had this giant compilation of everything thrown into my lap. The style and song and quality of these tracks vary so greatly, I don't know, I feel almost as if A.G. Cook fans or music fans of all stripes could go into this, taking away different highlights based on your tastes and the things that appeal the most to you. So, I don't know, screw it. Here are some quick thoughts on, like, all the tracks. Disc 1, track 1, A to Z. I love the glitchy drum and bass rhythms on this thing. The synth work is also quite insane. Awesome highlight, awesome intro. The following track, Acid Angel, also features some kind of glitchy, deconstructed beats, very rhythmically intense and exciting. But then H2O felt like this unnecessarily rhythmically grating motif that I got little to nothing out of. It was a huge turnoff and the first track that really faltered for me. Drum solo, that drum solo interlude transition, whatever you want to call it, and it was okay. Then I was pretty bewildered at the song New Crush. Like, what is this horrible 80s throwback pop hip hop beat with the gated drum timbre. It's terrible. I hate the groove. I hate the aesthetics of it. I hate everything. Gemstone Break is a wonderful, melodic, and thrilling piece of music that sounds like the soundtrack to, I don't know, the island level for a racing game with sort of an IDM twist. I love it. Then the first disc is finalized with the song Silver, which I found to be a dreamy little hyperpop ballad with an amazing beat, cool structure, epic transitions, though I thought the vocal performance could have been better. Then we move into the second disc of the album, which features a lot more guitar, opens up with the song Gold Leaf, which is a pretty light kickoff for this disc. It's a sweet, glistening little vocal interlude that I thought had some admirable aspects to it, but it's one more example of the singing not being as strong on this project as it could have been. Following this, track 2, disc 2, Being Harsh, which I felt was a miraculously good little bit of indie folk with some fantastic guitar work. From here, we have the song Undying, which I felt was another highlight, a lo-fi indie rock bit with some drum machines. Felt a little Unicorns-ish at points, especially on the vocal front. There were also some pretty cool enveloping synth layers that seemed to get thicker and thicker as the song moved along. Following this on Drink Blood, I was getting somewhat of a country vibe with all of the plucky, twangy guitar leads, something I thought would kind of develop into a sound that was more aligned with that genre. But for the most part, I think this song hangs in a very abstract place where it's not really devoted to any one single genre. My biggest takeaway from this track is that while there was some interesting vocal and guitar work on it, structurally it really could have used some more transitions, builds, really anything that made all of these ideas feel like they were coming together and becoming greater than the sum of their parts. Which is an issue I have with many tracks on this project, that a song may kick off with some great sounds, great ideas, but then A.G. Cook won't structurally build them out into anything that really hits hard or develops in a significant way. You never really know when you're going to get a song that feels complete, feels multifaceted, or is just a one-dimensional motif stretched out to like a full song's length. From here, the cut Lil song to me read like a very blissful, chimey piece of church music. I have no idea how we're moving down this road at this point, but I thought it was kind of cool and could have used some more length. Then, surprise, track 6 on this disc is a Blur cover of the song Beetlebum, and it's actually a really good cover. It's like an acoustic, little indie type ballad version of the original song, and I think AG pulls the whole thing off really well. Then, to round things out for the second disc, we have just a very raw live performance that to me came off kind of awkward. Then, transitioning next over to the third disc of the album, we have some of the most harsh synthesizer timbres on the entire thing. That's really kind of the sound and the tone that's leading the charge here. The opening track to this disc is the song Mad Max, and it legitimately does feel like it would be fitting to a scene from the original movie. There's a cinematic quality to it. It's very bright, it's very harsh, it's a little off-putting and tense. Then Biker Gang features more synth passages that feel almost like soundtrack work, this time coming off a lot less direct, more long-winded, and a bit tiresome. Then from here, Soft Landing, which might be my least favorite track on the disc. We have these faint, disembodied vocals meandering underneath these totally forgettable synth chords, and then we're getting these laser leads flying into the mix that just sound horrid. But then, in a total contrast of enjoyability, we have the song Overheim, which is a very pretty, droning, progressive synth piece with just some amazing compositional characteristics. On DJ Every Night, I feel like I'm listening to a satire of Deconstructed Club with all these very bright, blaring, sugary synths just being shot into my face, just beamed into my brain with like almost no dance beat in sight for the longest time. Car Keys kicks off like a throbbing, righteous synth pop piece, but it never actually turns into that very self-affirming synth pop type anthem. It's just kind of like a somewhat abstract motif that's extended out just a bit too far. But then we have the closer Dust, which I think is my favorite track on this disc, and sounds like more epic synth soundtrack work. The piece features all of these wailing lead melodies. It's very grand in scope, but those synth leads get more and more annoying, grating, and obnoxious as the track plods along. It's like the whole thing turns into sort of a nightmare, but I think that quality about it is pretty interesting. The following disc, the fourth disc, sees A.G. Cook having more piano passages dominate the narrative. The opener sounds like what you would hear if you were playing a Japanese RPG and you woke up in your house in your hometown and you were just starting to begin your adventures in the game, but then later, like a trap beat and some auto-tune vocals pop into the mix. It's okay. The following note velocity is actually one of my favorites on the entire record. It's like this series of experimental layers of stuttering notes and also minimalist arpeggios cycling and cycling and cycling with a very grand finale. It's actually amazing. Windows is a very glistening and low-key ballad that I thought was okay. Not a lot of teeth to it, but there was something about the singing and the writing on this song that reminded me quite a bit of Hannah Diamond, someone who I know A.G. Cook has worked with, so it's interesting to see that connection or that similarity there. Then the song Feeling to Me read like a very bad, cheap demo, one of the more underwritten tracks on the entire record. Vocals sounded like they were riffing, chord progression totally forgettable, and then finally the beat was really rickety. But from there, the following Waldhammer, which I felt was a little short, but still very bold in that it was like a combination of fast-paced classical music and black MIDI glitchy electronics. God, it's overwhelming. One of the more left field moments on this thing, to say the least. Then from here on the next track, we have more regal classical keys, but now with like some just thumping bass boosted beats. It kind of sounds like a combination of, I don't know, Baroque music and gabber. Then to close out on the song Anything Could Happen, we have one more kind of brief, pretty song concept that really could have been fleshed out a little bit more to achieve just a more satisfying progression. Then transitioning to disc 5, which may be my favorite disc on the record, we have A.G. coming through with more keys on the Nord. The opener sounds like the part of the Japanese RPG where your pixelated hero is holding like their sprite protege in their hands while they die just before like the last boss battle or whatever. It's absolutely beautiful. The second track brings more icy, introspective synthesizers backed with these intricate and abrasive IDM rhythms. The third song on this disc, The Best Day, is actually a Taylor Swift cover. The tune is nice, but A.G. morphs the song into something that matches the aesthetics of the rest of this disc. More icy, droning, chilly synthesizers, calming and digitally enhanced vocals. And it's so short it kind of feels like an interlude in the middle of this disc anyway. Triptych Demon gives us these post-industrial, glitchy beats, super oppressive, super hard-hitting, and then a spacious synth outro that's quite beautiful. Next, we have a cover of Charlie XCX's Official, which is okay. It's like a lower-impact version of the original where the vocals aren't nearly as good. Crimson is another shimmering, beautiful song concept that I wish just had more fleshing out or landed on the project of an artist that would really kind of sell it. And then finally, the closer of this disc gives us more bustling beats, anthemic lead melodies. The whole thing has this great fast pace to it, bright, bright, bright sounds. It's like I'm playing a racing game once again. Disc number 6, the spoken word disc, kicks off with some groovy rhythms. It's a kind of a chill motif with some very low-key spoken vocal samples laced in. It would be totally unrecognizable and generic otherwise. Like, there's nothing really defining compositionally or aesthetically about this track. Then from here, we get a Strokes cover of the song The End Has No End, which is a pretty fun song. I mean, it's one of my favorite Strokes tracks, but A.G.'s delivery here is much more robotic and rigid in comparison, and purposefully so. I think he's trying to give us kind of a slightly more soulless version of the song, maybe in a cheeky way. The track No Yeah, is this like an ASMR interlude or something? I mean, I don't know, it's kind of hot. Then Green Beauty seems like a very Laurie Anderson-ish vocal synth interlude that's quite ambient in tone, very abstract. It's interesting to hear AG take on this sound and this style and maybe just kind of give Anderson a bit of a nod. I don't know, but I don't know. While it's cool that he can attempt something like this, I didn't get a whole lot out of it. The following Unreal felt a little too pretentious to connect with as well. And then from there, 2021 features all of these somewhat girly raps backed with 808 drums. Then the final track, Hold On, features more ambient waves of synthesizers and heavily manipulated vocals. Very relaxing, very enveloping, while simultaneously sounding cold and futuristic. And honestly, the only track on this disc I think I kind of enjoyed. Then we have reached the final disc of this project, where the singing, the vocals, gets a bit bolder. The bulk of the covers on 7G also land on this disc. The opening track is an amazing cover of Smashing Pumpkins Today. I think AG's vocals like really hit that same Billy Corgan type of range, and I just love the way he embodied the track and the synth work that he did. It's a great revision. Following this, we have a super passionate cover of Sia's Chandelier. Now, if you've been listening to Cook's singing up to this point on this album, you know there's no fucking way in hell that he's hitting the same notes as Sia, and he absolutely is not. Vocally, he cannot fill Sia's shoes, but the passion is there. The passion is there. Like, he is trying to sing his goddamn ass off, and for the most part, he's selling it. He's selling it, and it is a cute revision, but not totally there. Then from here, we have a cover of Life Sims IDL, a track and an artist that previously I was not familiar with, though AG has some work out with Life Sim. And it's an electronic dance track that AG really strips back quite a bit, pulls a lot of the rhythms out, and then adds some additional synth work and layers. It's sort of like a chill, wondrous expression on the same musical motifs. Following this, track 4, Show Me What, with Cecile Believe collaborating with AG Cook, we have a twinkling pop banger with some great vocals. The chorus is super tight. I love the darting lead melodies too. Punchy beats, atmospheric production, easily one of the best tracks on the entire thing. Summer's Tape features some very chill and chipmunk lead vocals underneath these woozy synthesizers that get more intense as the song progresses. Kind of a cool combination of sounds, but not one of the best songs here. Track 6 gives us a psych pop throwback with a Tommy James and the Shondells cover of Crimson and Clover, and Cook is essentially giving us this knowingly tacky, synthed out arena rock rendition of this song that devolves into these additional passages on the back end that sound less and less like the original tune. I mean, it's easily the weirdest cover on the entire record, and I really, truly do admire the oddity of it. Then the closer I thought was another highlight. It's a glistening, heartening, playful little ballad with some rapped vocals from Tommy Cash. And you know what? That is 7G. That is this semi-enjoyable mess of songs. It's definitely an experience I encourage fans to take on if they have enjoyed anything AG Cook has been involved in, because again, even though it is gravely imperfect, it does give you a better sense artistically of like what makes the guy tick. Feeling a decent 2 strong 6 on this one. Transition, have you given this album a listen? Did you love it? Did you hate it? What would you rate it? You're the best, you're the best. What should I review next? Hit the like if you like. Please subscribe and please don't cry. Hit the bell as well. Over here next to my head is another video that you can check out. Hit that up or the link to subscribe to the channel. Anthony Fantano, AG Cook, forever.